Hello, Airbus Cockpit Coach here, and welcome to the channel. You're joining me inside the Fenix A320, and in this video, we're going to look at how we deal with a fuel leak. Before we do so, don't forget to hit that thumbs up button and give the video a like. So a fuel leak can be detected a number of different ways. We can get ECAM messages, one example of which is the fuel on board versus fuel use disagree message, but we won't always get that in the event of a fuel leak. So if the fuel leak occurs past the fuel metering valve on the aircraft, we're very unlikely to see that message, which is why it's important to conduct regular fuel checks. So whilst there are some monitors in place within the systems for fuel leak detection, where the fuel leak occurs will decide on whether those messages appear or not. So if the sum of fuel on board and fuel used is significantly less than the fuel on board at engine start, or is decreasing, or a passenger may observe fuel spray from the engine or the pylon or the wingtip, or if the total fuel quantity decreases at an abnormal rate and a fuel imbalance develops, we may notice that the fuel quantity of a tank decreases too fast, so that will indicate a leak from the engine or a pylon or a hole in the tank. Or if fuel flow is excessive, that may indicate a leak from an engine. And also if fuel is smelt inside the cabin, that's another indication. So if visibility permits, we would conduct a visual check from the side of the cabin over the wing area, looking at the engines and trying to identify if there's any spray coming off the surfaces of the aircraft. Whenever a leak is confirmed, we must land as soon as possible. And this is where things get a little bit interesting in the simulator, as we're most often single crewed, and we haven't got the benefit of a second pilot to assist us with planning our diversion. This is why it's important to always be continuously looking at your options through the course of a flight and getting those plan Bs into the secondary flight plan, for example, and having those up your sleeve. But there are a few different things we do depending on where the leak is coming from. So if we suspect that the leak is from the engine or the engine pylon, so an engine fuel leak can be confirmed by an excessive fuel flow indication, or of course the visual check. Of course, we'll be liaising with ATC and getting going with the diversion, but in terms of immediate actions for dealing with the leak itself, the first thing we'll do is come down and we move the thrust lever for the affected engine to the idle position. So let's say we suspect engine number one has a leak today. We confirm that thrust lever engine one confirmed, and we move back to the idle position. Then we move down and we select the engine master for the effective engine to off. We then come through a process of monitoring the fuel situation. So if that process stops the leak, so we're looking at the fuel flow, seeing what's going on with our balance, we can then come up and we can use the cross feed valve to rebalance the fuel quantity or enable use of fuel from both wings. If that has stopped the leak, we do not want to restart the engine. So obviously we want to run through the ECAM actions as well for engine one shutdown. So we're moving the start switch to ignition. That's for the benefit of engine two. But if no fuel leak, so we have a fuel leak situation, we can clear these actions out. So we've got an MCT thrust on engine two, ignition is on. Because there is a suspected fuel leak, we're not continuing with a restart procedure. If this scenario here now, we continue to have a fuel leak in this situation, we would ensure that the fuel cross feed valve remains closed, and we confirm that here on the lower ECAM. We'd ensure that the center tank, both pumps one and two, are off, which is the current situation. Confirmed. So each engine is being fed by its respective tank, and we monitor the depletion rates of the inner tank. It's important to close that cross feed so we ensure that we're not depleting fuel from both sides of the aircraft. So again, we're presuming we've got a leak somewhere over on the port left side of the aircraft. We don't want to be transferring fuel across. We've already shut down the engine on this side. Both engines are now operating again. So if we had a leak and it was not confirmed to be from the engine or the pylon, or the leak was not located, we would stop any fuel transfer situation that's going on, so the cross feed valve needs to be closed. That's important, and we want to monitor the depletion rate of each inner tank, determine if the leak is from the engine or or perhaps from the center tank or the APU feeding line. So we want to ensure the fuel crossfeed valve is closed, which it is. Center tanks 1 and 2 are off. I've got no fuel in there today. So we've now got a situation where each engine is being fed via its associated inner tank only. We continue to monitor the inner tank fuel quantities. But the important point there is that if we cannot locate the leak, that we're isolating the aircraft into two sides, and they're not connected by that crossfeed valve, or indeed the centre tanks. If one inner tank depletes faster than the other by at least 300 kilograms in less than 30 minutes, an engine leak may still be suspected. So in that situation, we'll move the throttle on the affected side back to idle. So engine 1, thrust lever, number 1 confirmed. That comes back to idle. Engine master on the leaking side comes to off. Engine 1 master confirmed, off. Center tank pumps 1 and 2, off. And we'll continue to monitor the fuel leak. I'm just going to deal with these ECAM actions. Engine mode selector ignition. If no fuel leak, we monitor the imbalance, and TCAS mode goes to the TA, and we can clear engine 1 shutdown, suspect a leak. Bleed associated, electrics associated. And again, in this situation, if the inner tank of the affected side stops decreasing, the engine leak is confirmed and stopped. We can then use the crossfeed valve on the overhead to rebalance the fuel quantity or to enable use of fuel from both wings. In this situation, we would not consider restarting the engine. If the leak continues after an engine shutdown, so the inner tank quantity continues to decrease, a leak from the wing may be suspected. In that situation, we can consider an engine restart. But there's a caution to this situation, so we do not apply the fuel imbalance procedure, which we covered in an earlier video. In this situation, approach and landing can be done even with one wing full and one wing empty. If both inner tanks deplete at a similar rate, a leak from the center tank or the APU feeding line may be suspected. If we have a smell of fuel in the cabin and we have our APU on, at this point we would turn it off with the intention of preventing additional fuel loss through the APU feeding line. It's important to note that in this situation, on landing, we do not use reversers. So no reverse thrust on landing. Obviously, we don't want to ingest fuel and throw it back forwards through the aircraft through hot engine parts. So to recap then, and I will put this into a document and post that in the Discord server document section, but we go through a process of trying to determine where the leak is coming from. We're looking at our fuel ECAM displays and also visually through our windows of the aircraft. And we're trying to narrow that down to whether it's from the engine or the pylon, and then we try and narrow it down to perhaps the wing or the center or APU lines. So we can kind of divide the aircraft up. So we've got the engine and pylons, we've got the wings on each side, and we've got the center tank and APU feed. They're the sort of three zones we can kind of narrow the fuel leak down to. If you do have major fuel loss, you know, a lot of fluid leaving the aircraft, do ensure that you are isolating the aircraft down the middle and not have that crossfeed valve open. That's really important. Protect the side that's safe. And don't forget, while we are doing this, we're ideally initiating or have initiated a diversion already. And this is where you'll see the benefit of dual cockpit crew in this situation. When you're fault finding like this, it is actually quite distracting. You can spend a lot of time analysing and looking at data. And it's really important not to get distracted from the primary task of aviating and ensuring you're getting the aircraft safely to its destination. If you have any questions on that at all, please drop them into the comments. And don't forget to hit like and subscribe to stay up to date with the latest content. I'll catch you on the next one. Thanks for watching.